So in the last video, I introduced you to the concept, to the research by Kahn, Wilson, and Stonekey. It was published in 1987. Now, a fundamental concept in their analytical approach is coalescence. So let's look at that one more time to make sure we're all on the same page. This figure should look familiar, though I have turned it to the side so that I could make it bigger and easier for you to see. The x-axis is time, measured in generations, and so you're going back in time as you move to the right. So G0 is today, and G17 is 17 generations back. There are 10 DNA sequences on the y-axis, so moving through a very hypothetical example to show you how coalescence analyses work, we would organize the sequence similarities and differences between those 10 individuals into nested clusters. So first off, let me show you some colors, which are supposed to be DNA sequences. So notice that there are two major categories. There's blue and there's pink. So these must be the oldest of the mutation events, the oldest founder events with a most recent common ancestor farthest back in time. And in this example, it's back at G13. And we estimate that it must be old because there is variation that's added on top of that, that's within those two clusters and not between them. So in mitochondrial DNA research, we call these two main clusters haplogroups. The haplogroups are defined by individuals who share a mutation, a particular base pair sequence, that's due to their common ancestry with a founder event back in deep time. And there is variation within those two main blocks, within those two haplogroups. So let's look at some more of that. So we see within the pink haplogroup that we have a lighter blue and a darker purple color. And then within the blue haplogroup, we have green and yellow. And those connect to these events here, kind of in, towards the middle of your screen, if it's hard to see that. And then within those, we see variation, but not across them, but within them. And so we have gray within the blue, two different shades of gray, and then we have turquoise and orange that correspond to these other events here, founder events. And then it can continue where we find some other variation nested within those haplogroups that correspond to these mutation events, these founder events. So this now is the concept that we want to apply to testing these hypotheses. So what did we learn from the Kahn, Wilson, and Stonekey research? Well, we learned that all of the human mitochondrial DNA variation today is nested within the mitochondrial DNA variation observed in Africa. So that pattern, that human variation is essentially all African, how does that relate to these two hypotheses? How can we use that to test them? Well, for multi-regionalism, Homo erectus first evolved in Africa and then expanded its range to include Eurasia. So that's basically the same pattern that the DNA indicates, right? The mitochondrial DNA rooted within Africa. So for the replacement model, it's basically the same thing. But instead of it being Homo erectus, it is Homo sapiens that first evolved in Africa and then expanded its range to include Eurasia. So you had a duplication of that pattern of diaspora. So the overarching pattern of relatedness is actually the same between them. So what's the fundamental difference then between the two models? Time. That's right. The difference is time. When did the diaspora happen? Well, long enough ago that the characters were Homo erectus, or recent enough that the players were Homo sapiens? Okay, so here is where we get to the next clever part of the Kahn, Wilson, and Stonekey study. They figured out a way to estimate time. They were able to add time into the analysis through the concept of the molecular clock. I mentioned in an earlier video in this module that it is a little tricky to estimate the rate that nuclear DNA mutates. And this is because some chromosomal regions are more prone to mutation than our other regions. Some nucleotides are more prone to mutation and recombination. Oh, that just makes all of this even a little more difficult to figure out. Also, different animals seem to have different rates of genetic mutation as well. But with all of those caveats, geneticists can still work out a general sense of how many mutations occurred over time on an evolutionary scale, because mutations are random events, and so the stochasticity of their occurrence can be modeled as an average number of mutations expected to have occurred over some set amount of time. The mutations that occur in DNA, they occur over basically a fairly uniform rate. The trick is to figure out some anchor in time in order to estimate the rate. And for this, geneticists turn to, well, the fossil record. So, for example, if we have a solid sense of when apes and monkeys last shared a common ancestor, and we know that there is some specific set number of base pair differences between us and baboons, we can estimate the mutations that led to the base pair differences. We can estimate that they must have occurred evenly over that known period of time. And voila, we have estimated a mutation rate. We have a molecular clock. And then you apply that to a branch that you don't actually know what the ancestor is. You don't know when that ancestor occurred. This means then that we calibrate the molecular clock with fossils. Okay, so this also means that we still have lots of debates over the calibration and all of the assumptions embedded in the time estimates. But for generality's sake, it does actually seem to work pretty well. So what Con Wilson and Stone King found when they applied that rate of mutation, the molecular clock, to the 147 human mitochondrial DNA sequences, is that all of the different mitochondrial DNA lineages seen today, when they work backwards to undo the mutations to find when they all coalesce with the most recent common ancestor, they coalesce around 200,000 years ago. Let's look at the models again. So what would be your time estimate for the coalescence in the multi-regionalism model? Well, thinking back to the fossils, something like 2 million years ago, based on what we know from the fossil record. Because remember, that's the oldest evidence that we have for when Homo erectus expanded their range across the Eastern Hemisphere. And for the replacement model, the 200,000-year coalescence estimate fits much better with this model. The mitochondrial DNA evidence basically rejects multi-regionalism and supports the replacement model. In an amazing coincidence, the mitochondrial DNA variation coalesces around the same time that we have the earliest fossil evidence of Homo sapiens. Remember that the skulls, those skulls that we talked about from Herto in Ethiopia? Homo sapiens and early Homo sapiens. Now, a most recent common ancestor for the mitochondrial DNA variation of living people. You know, this really resonated in people's minds when it was first published. Journalists just went crazy with this concept, like, woo, we have found the mother of us all. It called her mitochondrial Eve, much to the chagrin of a lot of evolutionary biologists, because that's not actually what this means. Let's think about what this actually does mean. The mitochondrial DNA most recent common ancestor, well, we know that she was not the only woman or person alive. We also know that she's not the ancestor of all of our genes. She's just this individual who ends up being a coalescence point in time for a small section of mitochondrial DNA. So just a handful of sequences out of the 3.2 billion nuclear base pairs and the just over 16,000 base pairs that make up the mitochondrial genome. We also know that she had a mother of her own, because who else did she get her mitochondrial DNA from? And we also know that she didn't necessarily have to be anatomically modern. Likely was, given the time. But there is a most recent common ancestor for every single bit of your DNA. Some of these are kind of recent, like what we observe for the mitochondrial DNA, and some of those coalescence points, some of those most recent common ancestors, they are much older, coalescing millions of years ago. So some of the genetic variation in our immune system genes, for example, they coalesce back closer to when we shared a last common ancestor with monkeys, which was like 20 million years ago. So there's absolutely no reason why a coalescence has to happen within the same species. Remember, evolution is shifts in populations over time. No mama ever gave birth to a baby that wasn't in her own species. There's been hundreds and hundreds of research projects since that 1987 paper that have explored mitochondrial DNA variation. We've added thousands and thousands of mitochondrial DNA sequences to the mix. And amazingly enough, all of those papers have come to a very similar conclusion of what Con Wilson and Stone King found, that the most recent common ancestor for mitochondrial DNA variation is about 150,000 to 200,000 years ago. It's really spectacular. But we can also use the variation, that nested patterning of the variation in mitochondrial DNA, to do something else that's kind of interesting. And I want to show you that next. So we can look at the proportions of these different haplogroups. Remember those deeper founder events? So we can look at the occurrence of those across populations. So here's a mitochondrial DNA haplogroup distribution map. You're looking at pie charts that correspond, or they sit on top of the geographic regions from which they were compiled. And you'll notice that the pie charts that are closer to each other geographically, they tend to look a little more similar. They have more similar occurrence of haplogroup representation in them. This means that we can use those similarities between these populations to get an estimate, to get a sense of what the migration patterns must have been and the time when they happen. So we can use these mitochondrial DNA haplogroups to study migration events. So here's a nice map out of this. These are the kinds of data that are used in those ancestry tests, like with 23andMe and Ancestry DNA, Ancestry.com. So this gives you a sense of that. And each of these letters that are here, these are major haplogroups within the mitochondrial genome. And that pattern is worked out from the nested hierarchy of those haplogroups. So we thought a bit about now mitochondrial DNA and that unilineal inheritance pattern through the maternal lineage. Now we can flip this around and look at Y DNA as well. Because remember, females have two X chromosomes and only males have a Y chromosome. So Y DNA similarly has this unilineal descent pattern, just inherited from father to son, father to son, father to son, over the generations. So people have sequenced the Y DNA, and really similar to what they did with mitochondrial DNA, is formed those nested hierarchies of the haplogroups, and from that worked out these migration patterns. And they look remarkably similar to what you see with the mitochondrial DNA. So putting it all together with molecular clock estimates, we have the mitochondrial DNA, most recent common ancestor, estimated to be about 150,000 to 200,000 years ago. And the Y DNA, most recent common ancestor, what? Estimated to be 120,000 years ago to 160,000 years ago. But that's earlier. Well, interesting thing about this is that been a lot of studies, and so while there is error embedded in every study, consistently the Y DNA most recent common ancestor is coming back as having been quite a bit more recent than the mitochondrial DNA ancestor, which means there's something different happening on the female side of ancestry and the male side of ancestry. There was a really interesting paper that was published a couple years ago. That was by a couple of colleagues, and I want to show you a figure out of that here. So Zhang and Feldman, it published in 2018 in Nature Communications. So they looked at a tremendous amount of data for Y sequence and mtDNA, so mitochondrial DNA sequences, and looked at what the variation was when the coalescent patterns were through time. And so you can see those phylogenies at the top for the Y chromosome on the left and the mitochondrial DNA on the right. And then below that, they have these really neat graphs that gives you a sense of that, the coalescence and also the range of variation of genetic variation within each of those along time. So time is on the x-axis, and it goes from zero today on the far right-hand side, and on the far left-hand side, you're looking at thousands of years ago, so 100,000 years ago. And then the dotted red line is at 50,000 years ago, and then there's another dashed red line at 10,000 years ago. And you can see that at 50,000 years ago, you start to get this ramping up of genetic variation in both the Y chromosome and in the mitochondrial DNA variation. But then when you get to 10,000 years ago, boom, something strange happens with Y chromosomes, like a dramatic reduction in the genetic variation. And yet, the exact opposite is happening in the mitochondrial DNA genetic variation. That just keeps expanding and keeps expanding. So for this, I'm actually going to turn you over to read a news article that describes the analyses and why they think this is what happened, or what their interpretation of this. So the evidence, the genetic evidence indicates that this is what happened, but why? So check out the news article and then also do your activity for Module 4. And then come back, because our next video, we are going to turn to the ancient mitochondrial DNA evidence. So instead of only looking at mitochondrial DNA variation of people alive today, starting in 1997, we get into DNA that's extracted from fossils. And the very first study was mitochondrial DNA that was extracted from actually the type specimen of the Neanderthals. With that, I'll see you on the other side. Take care.